I'll bring you one inshallah. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تبارك وتعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة أما بعد والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. What's the day today?
Ninth.
Today is the 9th of April 2019 and walillah alhamdu wa shukr, and by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's permission, and to Him alone belong all praise and thanks. We're gathered here again on the 9th of April in the masjid, ICT masjid, to continue our lessons on al-isti'dadu li shahri Ramadan al-mubarak, preparation for the blessed month of Ramadan. Now, haqiqatan ya ikhwani wa akhwati fillah, seldom or very rarely will you come to a lecture, especially like Ramadan, and hear something that you didn't already know prior to coming to the lecture. Seldom. It's very, very rare that it will happen. Most of us have fasted maybe 7, 8, 9 Ramadans. So oftentimes, the information that you hear in lectures like this, you've heard it before. But as Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala mentions in the Quran, إِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, that indeed the remembrance or the reminder benefits the believer. And sometimes that's what we need. It's almost like a prep talk before a match. We need to be reminded of those things that perhaps we already knew, but just so that we can refresh that information in our memory. Does that make sense, ikhwan? Jazakum Allahu khayran. So last week, in our last lesson, we covered a few important points, and inshallah ta'ala today we're going to carry on where we left off and expand on that inshallah ta'ala. And from the things that we covered in our last lesson was, number one, the meaning of as-siyam or sawm linguistically and in the religion. For those brothers or sisters for that matter that were present in our last lesson, who can remember, what does as-sawm mean linguistically? كنت غائبا, you wasn't here, he was absent. Who can remember what as-siyam linguistically in the language? Sawm, what does it mean? To? Again? Excellent, yani to abstain from. To abstain, to stay away from, to leave off, alright? If you want. But more accurately, to abstain from or to refrain. Now, who can remember the meaning of as-sawm in the religion? The meaning of sawm, ma'ana as-sawm, istilahan.
Abstain with
intention. Mumtaz, excellent. And and we said that was a distinguishing feature between the linguistic and the Islamic meaning. To just stay away from something is a form of sawm. Whether you stay, if you stop speaking, that's a form of sawm. All right. I gave you the example. If we said Sam al Matar, the rain, yani Sam, the rain Sam, yani we wouldn't say it fasted. We would say the rain didn't drop. All right, Sam al Matar, it didn't rain. And also, we looked at the verse in the Quran where Maryam alayha salam, she used the word son, when she said that she vowed to the Most Merciful that she would not speak to anybody. If you go back to the Arabic, you'll see that the word son is used. Now the difference between the linguistic meaning and the religious meaning is, like the brother said, what's your name, Akhi? Muhammad. Muhammad said, is to stay away from something with an intention, i.e. when we're speaking about Psalm in the religion, is to stay away from anything that breaks your fast with the intention to do so. All right? And that is crucially important as it relates to the difference between the two. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah. We also covered the reason why, or the benefit, or the reason why a Psalm has been obligated on the Muslims. Who can remember? Why have we been obligated to fast? What does Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala say in the Quran? Naam, tafadl. Labas. Excellent, akhi. The reason why Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, from the reasons that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has made fasting incumbent upon the Ummah is such that we can attain a taqwa. Who knows the ayah in the Quran? Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. La. كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لماذا لعلكم تتقون وهذا هو الجواب. That's the answer right there. لعلكم تتقون. And we explained so many times, مرارا وتكرارا, يعني over and over again, that the meaning of التقوى is to place between yourself and your sins. ماذا? What do we place between them? A wall or a barrier. That is التقوى. So you can apply that in any situation you want, whether that relates to stealing, whether that relates to, you know, looking at a woman, whatever you have to do to place between yourself and a sin, a barrier, that is a form of taqwa in al-Islam. And we finished on, if you guys can remember, and the verse in the Quran, I read the whole verse, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who have attained faith, كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون أياما معدودات فمن كان منكم مريضا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخر وعلى الذين يطيقونه فدية طعام مسكين فمن تطوع خيرا فهو خير لك وأن تصوموا خير لكم إن كنتم تعلمون. Oh, you have attained faith. Fasting has been prescribed upon you just like it was prescribed on those that came before you, so that you can be a people that gain a taqwa. It is a number of days. Whomsoever from among you is sick or on a journey, then they are to make up those days after the fast has completed, i.e. after Ramadan has completed. And then Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says something interesting, and I want to know who can remember what benefit we extracted from this part of the ayah. Allah تبارك وتعالى يقول وعلى الذين يطيقونه سوري إخوان وعلى الذين يطيقونه فدية طعام مسكين فمن تطوع خيرا فهو خير له وأن تصوموا خير لكم إن كنتم تعلمون. And for those who are able to fast but with difficulties, thus they don't fast, then they are to expiate for that fast by feeding a miskin. And whomsoever is able to do extra, yani from the fasting, then it is better for him. And that you fast is better for you if you only knew. What did we say the significance of this ayah, or this part of the ayah was? Because it's one ayah, it's a long ayah.
At first, there was a choice between obligatory as no choice, and you have to do it, or...
Repeat that again, Sheikh Musa. Repeat that again for me.
At first,
uh-huh,
there was a choice.
Yes.
You could either fast.
Excellent.
Or decide to feed the poor and the miskin. So there was a choice. And then came another ayah to tell this one that now you must fast.
You guys understand what Sheikh Musa said? Sheikh Mustafa? You understand what Sheikh Musa said?
He said you had to fast.
La. He was explaining the significance of this part of the ayah. وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُتِيقُونَهُ فِدْيَةٌ تَعَامُ مِسْكِينَ فَمَنْ تَتَوَّعَ خَيْرًا فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ وَأَنْ تَسُومُ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. He explained the significance of this ayah. What did he say? What did Sheikh Musa say? What is the significance of this part of the ayah? لا. ما في مشكلة. ما في مشكلة. The significance of this part of the ayah, إخواني وأخواتي في الله, is as follows. Initially, when Psalm was sent down upon the Muslims, it wasn't an obligation like it's an obligation now. It was optional. Those that wanted to fast, they fasted. Those that, كما قال الله تبارك وتعالى وعلى الذين, and upon those يطيقونه, who are able to fast, but the meaning is, but with difficulties. Upon them, what is the expiation for that? فدية طعام مسكين. The expiation is to feed a miskin. So the Muslims had a choice in the early days. They could either fast and that was it, or they could feed a miskin if they were unable to fast, or they could fast with great difficulties and that would compensate for their fast. طيب. And then who knows the next ayah in this surah? I don't even mind if you check in your phones. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. A guidance for the people. Keep going. نعم. فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم. هكذا قال الله تبارك وتعالى. فمن شهد منكم الشهر. Whomsoever from among you, يعني is alive and they witness the month, i.e. you're not a traveler, you're not sick, you're a resident, فليصم. Then he must fast. This word here, فَلْيَصُمْ, for those that have studied Arabic or studying Arabic, will realize that it's a command form of the verb. It's in the present tense. It's in the present tense. But this lam at the beginning, fal, that lam there that we stop on, is the lam of al-amr, a lam of command. So what is the significance between these two things that I've just mentioned? The significance is this. Initially, fasting wasn't an obligation and then it became an obligation. Sah? This goes to show and prove the science of what we call in Arabic النَّاسِخ وَالْمَنْسُوخ. النَّاسِخ وَالْمَنْسُوخ. النَّاسِخ وَالْمَنْسُوخ refers to the science of those verses in the Quran that came down and abrogated other verses. Does that make sense, Ikhwani? There are certain verses in the Quran that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala revealed in His infinite wisdom. Then later on, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala revealed another verse talking about the same issue, which cancelled out that previous verse. You with me, guys? And when you study the science of al-nasikh wal-mansukh, you study the different ways that certain things can abrogate other things. For example, we can abrogate Quran with the Quran, like this ayah here: وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُتِيقُونَهُ فِدْيَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينٍ. For those that are able to fast but with great difficulties, then they are able to feed a miskin. Then Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says after that, فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْ. This ayah from the Qur'an abrogated, wiped out, cancelled out another ayah from the Qur'an. So this is an example of doing al-nasikh wal-mansukh, verses of abrogation, using the Qur'an to abrogate the Qur'an. Alright? We've also got proof in the sunnah for this science, al-nasikh wal-mansukh, whereby the sunnah can also abrogate the sunnah. When An-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made the Isra wal Mi'raj, Muhammad ibn Adil. When An-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made al-Isra wal Mi'raj, he ascended the night journey through to the seven heavens. And then he got to the point where he was taken up to speak to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. How many salawat did Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala ordain upon the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam initially? 50 salawat. Then we know, everybody knows the story. The Prophet ﷺ went down until he met who? Musa alayhi salam. Musa said, your ummah won't be able to handle that. Go back and ask your Lord for takhfif. Yani make it lighter. So it went down from 50, 45, 40, 35, 30 until we reached down to what?
Five.
Is this not an example, ikhwani wa akhawati fillah, of the sunnah making naskh, yani abrogating the sunnah? Initially it was 50. And then it went all the way down until it went down to eventually 5 salawat. So the science of al-nasikh wal-mansukh is a tremendous science in the religion, and it requires somebody obviously to study. And without, you know, knowing the conditions of al-nasikh wal-mansukh and when this ayah was revealed compared to the other ayah, you will not be able to study this science adequately. But it still remains that this is a science in the religion of al-Islam. Alright? A science in the religion of al-Islam. Any questions, Ikhwani, from what I've presented so far? No questions? Mumtaz. Tayyib. إخواني وأخواتي في الله بلوغ رمضان نعمة كبيرة على من بلغه وقام بحقه بالرجوع إلى ربه من معصيته إلى طاعته ومن الغفلة عنه إلى ذكره تبارك وتعالى ومن البعد عنه إلى الإنابة إليه. Brothers and sisters, the arrival of the month of Ramadan is a tremendous blessing, كما قال أبو سمية, for the one who Allah تبارك وتعالى allows to reach this month. And not only does Allah تبارك وتعالى allow this individual to reach this month, but this individual, he قام بحقه. He establishes the rights of Ramadan. Because as we know, Ramadan is more than just simply leaving off food and drink. صح ولا لا? It's more than even leaving off those things which we're supposed to stay away from anyway, like al-ghiba, wal-namima, and stuff like that. There are those things which are usually halal for the Muslim to engage in, which between set hours are haram upon the Muslim. Alaysa kadhalik? And again, from the biggest fruits and benefits of Ramadan is that we gain at-taqwa. So the one that enters into Ramadan and he thinks it's just all about staying away from food and drink from al-fajr ila al-maghrib, or staying away from music from these two times, or staying away from smoking from these two times, is horribly mistaken. Alright? Horribly mistaken. So the one that qama bihaqqihi, he stands in the month of Ramadan, or he establishes the rights of Ramadan, and what does he do? He turns back to his Lord, tabaraka wa ta'ala, and he refrains from those... Alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And he refrains from committing any sins to the best of his ability, and he turns to the obedience of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And in addition, he turns away from, he increases what the... Al-ghafla, heedlessness, the heedlessness that he had of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala prior to the month of Ramadan, he tries to the best of his ability to establish himself in the remembrance of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And for those of us who are far away from Ramadan, far away from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, before the month becomes, we strive to the best of our ability to use this precious time such that we can gain a closeness to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Ikhwani, does that make sense? So far. So if I were to ask you guys, from the things that we've covered in last lesson and this lesson, what are some of the things that the Muslim can do in preparation for Ramadan? What would you guys say? Just throw it from the floor. Make tawbah to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Don't wait for the month of Ramadan to come and then we start turning back to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. We need, as I've said in a previous lesson, we need to hit the floor running. Like anything that you would want to do, any endeavor that you try to embark upon, you want to hit that, start that thing hitting the ground running. So it's now, this time now, this month before Ramadan drops, this is when we need to start making a tawbah. Anybody else? What are some of the things that we can do in preparation for the blessed month of Ramadan?
Increase your recitation.
Excellent. Do you know how difficult it is, or how much a person is going to get, or how easily a person is going to become burnt out if they start to read the Kitab of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala in the month of Ramadan, on top of being hungry, thirsty, and your body just being tired from the Qiyam from the night before? It's going to be very, very difficult. We need to try to نعم يعني يتعود الجسم to, what's the word for يتعود? When you get something used to something, we need to get our bodies accustomed to, and our throats and our minds accustomed to reading the book of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. This is the month of the Quran. Barakallahu fiqh. What's your name, Akhi?
Ubaid.
Khubayb. Barakallahu fiqh. Excellent. Sheikh Musa, how can one make al isti'dad for the blessed month of Ramadan?
Increasing nawafil.
Jade.
Any nawafil, like the sunnah, in your prayers. Perhaps also start to fast, like this month, they ask us to.
Fantastic.
They advise us to fast as much as we can.
Fantastic.
As long as we don't be fasting all month.
Mumtaz.
So you get used to.
Excellent. Mumtaz. Excellent. Okay. Who remembers last week, Ikhwani, when I mentioned in the lecture that sometimes in order to understand the tremendous and lofty status of a thing, we have to know more about it. Once you know more about the tremendous lofty status of a particular act of worship, it will be easier for us to carry out the act of worship. Why? Because we know we're doing it not just taqleedan, We're just following everybody else, or we're just doing it because we have to do it. La, we're doing it because we actually know the fruits and the benefits of the fast. Does that make sense, Ikhwani? It's so important, not just for Ramadan. For anything that you do, you need to learn the benefits. And once you do that, you're able to, and you're going to strive to do it even more so. So, your question? So, as it relates to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and his lifetime, who knows how many Ramadans the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam fasted? Who knows how many times the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fasted before he passed away? It's not a big deal if you don't know. It's just interesting to know. Sah wa dala? You say four?
Five.
You say five? Two? Just out of curiosity, are we guessing? Are we just taking stabs in the dark or? No, I'm just in, legitimately any curious. Guess?
Five. But when was the ayah revealed? Depends on when the ayah was revealed.
Was it after Hijrah? This ayah here? Was this after the Hijrah? I believe so. It's the second year after the Hijrah.
And how many years?
Of course, that's the big question. That's the big question. Mumtaz. Closer. Not correct, but closer.
Is it 12?
La. One more. Ashendek. Let's read what the Sheikh says. By the way, the notes that I'm presenting for this particular class, I don't get from one source. I get from here and there and everywhere, but it's based upon the kalam of the ulama, either Sheikh bin Baz or Sheikh Muhammad al-Uthaymeen, rahimahullah ta'ala. And what I'm about to read here is part of a fatwa that was on the website of Sheikh Abdulaziz ibn Ubaz. يقول صيام شهر رمضان هو ركن من أركان الإسلام الخمسة. That fasting in the blessed month of Ramadan is a pillar from the five pillars of Al-Islam. فرض على المسلمين في السنة الثانية من الهجرة. That's a big clue. الصيام was made an obligation, I think you asked this here, in the second year of the Hijrah. Furida, yani when you hear the word furid, it means it became an obligation. Furida ala al-Muslimin, Siyam was made an obligation on the Muslims when? Fi sanati thaniya min al-Hijrah, in the second year after the Hijrah. Wa sama al-Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, tis'a Ramadanat. He fasted 9 Ramadans. قال الإمام النووي رحمه الله تعالى في كتابه المجموع صام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رمضان 9 سنين. He fasted. Imam al-Nawawi said in his book al-Majmu' that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم he fasted Ramadan for 9 years. I.e. 9 Ramadans. لأنه فرض في شعبان في السنة الثانية من الهجرة. Because Ramadan, somebody asked me over here, when was that ayah, I think it was you, Akhi, when was the ayah, Talib, when was the ayah revealed? It says, لِأَنَّهُ فُرِدَ فِي شَعْبَانَ فِي السَّنَةِ الثَّانِيَةِ مِنَ الْهِجْرَةِ. Because the fasting was revealed, the ayah of fasting was revealed in Sha'ban, in the second year of the Hijrah. وَتَوُفِّيَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فِي شَهْرِ رَبِيعِ الْأَوَّلِ سَنَةَ 11 مِنَ الْهِجْرَةِ. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is said that he died in the month of Rabi' al-Awwal, in the 11th year of the Hijrah. So take away 2 from 11, you're left with?
9.
That's how many years the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam fasted this blessed month. Tayyib. Knowing that information, is that going to increase you in Iman or decrease you in Iman? Probably won't increase you in Iman, but it's just interesting. Alright? It's just interesting to know about the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Tayyib. Hukum al-Siyam. Hukum al-Siyam. Whenever you hear the word al-hukum or ma huwa al-hukum al-siyam, what is the ruling of XYZ or fasting or as-salah or whatever the question is about, then we're looking at words like, is it haram? Is it wajib? Is it mustahab? Is it makruh? And the likes, alright guys? Whenever you hear the word hukum, that is what is requested from you. Al-Sheikh, na'am, ma huwa hukum al-siyam? Barakallahu feekum. Hal huwa wajib? Hal huwa sunnah?
Wajib.
Wajib. Barakallahu feek. Siyam Ramadana wajibun ala kulli muslimin. Tayyib. Ala kulli muslimin? Ala kulli muslimin?
Illa al-marid.
Aw illa al-marid. Kalamuhu sahih?
Is it?
Aw al-majnoon? المسافر ممتاز إذا لم يبلغ أيوة الحامل حملة حامل شوف الولد هذا هل يجب عليه الصيام لأنه لم يبلغ بعد البلوغ يعني شرط من الشروط والمسافر ليس لا يجب على المسافر الصيام نعم أكمل أيوة إذا كان المرأة يعني حائضا فلا يجب عليها ماذا الصيام ممتاز فصيام رمضان واجب على كل مسلم بالغ عاقل يعني ضد مجنون عاقل صحيح صحيح نعم ومقيم يعني صحيح is not sick and مقيم is not a traveler دل عليه دل على وجوبه الكتاب والسنة وإجماع الأمة وإجماع الأمة Fasting in the month of Ramadan, ikhwani wa akhwati fillah, as we all know, is an obligation on every single Muslim, male and female, who fulfill the following criteria. They have to be baligh, i.e. they have to have attained the age of puberty. They have to be aqil, they have to have their intellect in place. They also have to be sahih, yani they have to be well, able to fast and not sick. And they also have to be muqeem. Muqeem, in the Arabic language, means a residence. And we have proof from the kitab, we have proof from the sunnah, and also the ijma' of the ummah. What does ijma' al-ummah mean, Sheikh Musa? Ijma' al-ummati. What does ijma' al-ummati mean?
Concession of the...
Lays a concession. Close, but not concession.
Consensus.
Consensus. Ma'alesh.
No, my English.
No, it's okay, Sheikh. We all know what you mean. That's the important thing. طيب. شيخ أبو سمية ما هو الدليل من الكتاب يدل على وجوب الصيام هل السؤال واضح يا إخوان ممتاز ما في مشكلة قلت يا أبا سمية أو أبو سمية ما هو الدليل What is the proof على أن الصيام واجب من في الكتاب يعني في القرآن What is the proof That الصيام is wajib an obligation in the Quran. في سورة البقرة نعم. على الذين من قبلهم لعلكم تتقون ممتاز ممتاز وكذلك آية فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصوم whomsoever witnesses the month then let him fast. Also من السنة من يعرف الدليل من السنة على وجوب الصيام بني الإسلام على خمس نعم شهادتي أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله إلى آخر الحديث وصوم رمضان أيوة جيد ممتاز 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 but not many people will know that unless أيوة جيد وكذلك there's another hadith from the sunnah that I want to mention today and it's obviously this is the most famous hadith بني الإسلام we all know this but perhaps Not many people know this hadith, or they may have heard this, but not realize it's a dalil for the wajub of as-siyam. من السنة حديث طلحة ابن عبيد الله رضي الله تعالى عنه أن أعرابيا جاء إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ثائر الرأس. ثائر الرأس meaning he was somewhat disheveled and unkept. All right. فقال يا رسول الله أخبرني ماذا فرض الله علي. This Bedouin Arab, he came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, O Messenger of Allah, inform me of that which Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has made incumbent upon me min as-salah, yani from the prayers. You guys familiar with this narration? Na'am? Jayd. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الصلوات الخمسة. Yani, there are five, the obligatory prayers are five in number. إلا أن تتوع شيئا except if you're able to do more what is the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام intending here when he says except if you can do more نوافل فقال يعني the Bedouin man he said أخبرني when you hear the word أخبرني it means inform me أخبرني ما فرض الله علي من الصيام somebody should be able to translate that ayah that sentence right now right there أخبرني ما فرض الله علي من الصيام
Inform me what is obligatory upon me when it comes to fasting?
As concerning the fast. Concerning the fast. There's a reason, Ikhwan, I could do all of this this lesson in English. It'd be tremendously easy for me, and it will obviously be easy for you. But the point is, I want to introduce as much, to the best of my ability, and without overburdening you all, Arabic into your lives. You with me? This is why I'm sometimes I'll say, Furid means to be obligated. Such that when I'm speaking in Arabic, you guys can understand the first time round. Make sense? So he says, inform me what Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has made obligatory upon me concerning As-Siyam. ماذا قال النبي؟ فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم شهر رمضان إلا أن تتوع شيئا. He said that it's the fast in the month of Ramadan, except if you're able to do more. فقال, يعني the Bedouin Arab, he said, أخبرني بما فرض الله علي من الزكاة. Inform me what Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has made an obligation upon me as it relates to الزكاة. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فأخبره رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم شرائع الإسلام. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he informed him of the signs or the symbols of al-Islam, including what is upon the person as it relates to al-Zakat. He informed him. قَالَ وَالَّذِي أَكْرَمَكَ لَا أَتَتَوَّعُ شَيْئًا وَلَا أَنْقَصُ مِمَّا فَرَضَ اللَّهُ عَلَيَّ شَيْئًا. So the man said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, by the one who's honored you, who was he talking? وَالَّذِي أَكْرَمَكَ Allahu tabarak wa ta'ala. The Bedouin Arab said to the Prophet, وَالَّذِي أَكْرَمَكَ أَنْتَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ By the one who has... Sorry, guys. I think my mouth touched the mic. Got hair in my mouth. He says, وَالَّذِي أَكْرَمَكَ By the one who has honored you, O Muhammad, لَا أَتَتَوَّعُ I will not perform anything extra, شَيْئًا وَلَا أَنْقَصُ مِمَّا فَرَضَ اللَّهُ عَلَيَّ شَيْئًا I'm not going to do anything extra other than what you just said, and I'm not going to decrease in the slightest from what you just said. فَقَالَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَفْلَحَ إِن صَدَقَ ماذا قال؟ أَفْلَحَ إِن صَدَقَ If he is speaking the truth, then he, by Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala's permission, will succeed. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, or he says, أَوْ دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ إِن صَدَقَ The narrator of the hadith, he said that the Prophet either said aflaha in sadaqah, he has succeeded if he's telling the truth, or dakhala al-jannah in sadaq. If he's telling the truth, he will enter Jannah. Either, the meaning is the same. If somebody succeeds, obviously they succeed by entering the paradise. Does that make sense, ikhwani wa akhwati fillah? Naam. Any questions? And finally, for this hadith here, Ruahu al-Bukhariyu wa Muslimun. Ruahu al-Bukhariyu wa Muslimun. And the hadith that the brother mentioned, Ismail Mush, is also muttafaqun alayhi, yani Ruahu Bukhariyu wa Muslimun. And finally, ikhwani wa akhwati fillah, ajma' al-Muslimuna ala anna al-siyam wa anna al-sawma rukunun min arkan al-islami al-ma'luma min al-dini bil-durura bihaythu yakfur munkarahu. وأنه لا يسقط من المكلف إلا بعذر من الأعذار الشرعية المعتبرة التي سيأتي ذكرها إن شاء الله تبارك وتعالى. Last and finally, Ikhwan, and I want you to pay attention to the tartib, the order in which I have presented you guys with the dalil today. Lastly, the Ummah have unanimously agreed that Sawm, fasting, is a pillar from the pillars of Al-Islam, which are معلومة من الدين بالضرورة. When you hear al-ma'lum or al-ma'luma min ad-deen bid-durura means fasting is known to be from the religion of al-Islam by necessity. There's no excuse for a person who's a Muslim to say, I didn't know that I had to fast. Even the non-Muslims know that when Ramadan comes, the Muslims fast. It's something that ignorance and being heedless of this tremendous act of worship isn't an excuse. Make sense, Ikhwan? It's ma'lum, well-known, min ad-deen, from the religion, bid-durura. By necessity. Make sense, Ikhwan? Jade. And then the Shaykh goes on to say, such that if a person disbelieves or denies the obligation of fasting, he's outside the fold of Al-Islam. Because think about it. Somebody that says, la, we don't have to fast, or la, I don't believe it's an obligation. then he is denied what Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala said in the Quran, and additionally, he has denied what the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has said in various authentic hadith. Does that make sense? Then the Shaykh says, وَأَنَّهُ لَا يَسْقُطُ مِنَ الْمُكَلِّفِ. Fasting is not dropped from the one that is legally responsible. I translate the word al-mukallif as the one that is legally responsible in Islam. Alright? Legally responsible in Islam. Once you're legally responsible, ya akhi Muhammad ibn Adil, once you're legally responsible in the religion of al-Islam, fasting will never be dropped, except if somebody has a legitimate Islamic excuse, like we covered earlier on today. Somebody's sick, somebody's traveling, a woman's pregnant and she fears for her baby, somebody, a woman is on her menses. Now guys, I've taken the first two lessons and we're going to speak more about the fada'il of Ramadan, the virtues of Ramadan, in last lesson and this lesson. And then next week, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to start to enter into, well, how do we know the month of Ramadan is upon us? And oftentimes, every year Ramadan comes and goes, there are certain masail that always get asked. And I'm going to try to preempt what's going to happen, inshallah ta'ala, this Ramadan, and present some commonly asked questions during this month, such that inshallah ta'ala we can be prepared. Now, I mentioned I want you guys to pay attention to the tartib. Ma ma'na tartib, akhi?
The order.
The order. Tartib is the order. What tartib, akhi al-kareem?
Nuruddin.
Huh? I haven't asked the question yet.
They're going to ask you the question.
I'm going to ask you now. I just wanted to get your attention first, and then I'll ask the question. The question is, what was the tartib that I used when presenting the obligation of Ramadan? What was the tartib I used? The order. What was the order I used?
Stages of Ramadan, right?
La. Right now, we just discussed the obligation of Ramadan, right? And I cited different pieces of adilla. What was the order that I cited those adilla in, those proofs and evidences in? What did I say first? Then what? No, I don't want you to tell me what proof I used, but where did I quote from first? Where did I quote from second? Where did I quote from third?
I think the first one is quoted the ayat of
the Quran. Aha, so the first one was the Kitab of Allah. Next one. Who said it? Ijma'. Ikhwani, this is what I got. We've got seeking knowledge, which is muhim jiddan. And then we've got also an etiquette on how we present information once you've sought knowledge. Had I come here today and I said, ajma' al-muslimuna ala anna siyam al-ramadan wajibun, قال الإمام فلان وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ثم قلت وقال الله. I started telling you about how Siyam is, there's ijma from the Ummah. This Sheikh said this, this Sheikh said that, that Sheikh said this. And then I said, and the Prophet عليه السلام said, and then I said, and Allah said. This tartib isn't necessarily wrong, but it's not a, it's, how can I put this in a nice way? Exactly. We have to have al-adab when it comes to seeking knowledge, and also al-adab when it comes to presenting that knowledge. And at the end of the day, it's all about getting connected to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. As a talib or as an instructor, whatever category I fall under, it's my responsibility to the congregation or whoever's listening to connect you guys to Allah, not to connect you to myself and say, I think, or not to necessarily connect you solely to a sheikh, because we don't do personality worships in al-Islam. My job is to connect you with the kalam of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, and then the speech of the Prophet alayhi salam. Anything after that, then is khair, as long as it's in conformity with those two things. Does that make sense, Ikhwani? So you have to beware. You have to beware, even in front of myself, if I slip one day. If you listen to a speaker and they don't give you no qala Allah wa qala Rasul, qala Sahaba, qala al-ulama, then you have to be worried, like, what are you really giving me? What was sufficient for the Prophet ﷺ in his time when he was given or conveying knowledge should be sufficient now. But ma'al asaf al-shadeed, with great regret. What do we see nowadays? We see when people get in front of the MIC, the mic, they like to tell a lot of stories because we like to be entertained. Are you not entertained? Huh? Allahu Akbar. We like to be entertained, right? This is the reality, and this is how the da'wah has become, a da'wah of entertainment. So we can't grab people's attention unless we're singing poetry or doing anashid, halal anashid, if there's such a thing. Or I'm telling you a story that I don't even know if it's authentic or not. This is how the da'wah has become nowadays. Such that when somebody does want to give you qala Allah wa qala Rasul, it's sa'ab, it's difficult. You're worried, are the people even going to pay attention to what I have to say? This is the reality. So we have to try to make ourselves and train ourselves to want and look for the correct knowledge. Does that make sense, Ikhwan? It's crucially important. Tayyib. From the benefits of the blessed month of Ramadan is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa ala alihi wasallam informed us in an authentic hadith collected by Imam Muslim. يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه وغفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whomsoever fasts the blessed month of Ramadan, and the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام mentioned two tremendously important characteristics. What did he say? إيمانا واحتسابا. Guys, remember this. I guarantee you, if Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala blesses us to live for the next 60 days, i.e. these 30 days coming up and the days of Ramadan, you're going to hear this hadith mentioned in the khutbah. You're going to probably hear this hadith mentioned before the imam, at least Taraweeh, somebody gives a kalima tayyibah. This hadith is going to be mentioned. Understand what imanan wa ihtisaban means. Inshallah Ta'ala, I'm going to try to the best of my ability to explain it. And now, imanan wa ihtisaban. Imanan, having true conviction that this is an obligation that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala obligated on the Muslims. Tayyib. And not only do you believe that it's an obligation, but it's not permissible for the Muslim to dislike or to reject this obligation. This is what's intended by imanan. So we believe, whoever fasts the month of Ramadan, imanan bihi, with full conviction in it that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala obligated it upon us. And he doesn't dislike the fact that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala obligated upon us. Wahtisaban, i.e. seeking the reward from Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala for carrying out this tremendous act of worship. That's what's upon the Muslim. Fasting, knowing that Allah and believing that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala made this action obligatory, and also seeking the reward from Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Alright guys? Crucially important. In another hadith, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام يقول يعني وَمَنْ قَامَ لَيْلَةَ الْقَدْرِ إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِ. Whomsoever stands on the night of Laylatul Qadr, which is something inshallah ta'ala that we're going to cover near the end of this series, with faith and wahtisaban, seeking the rewards from this particular night, then Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will forgive his previous sins. So from the many benefits of the month of Ramadan is it's an opportunity for the male and female, Muslims of course, to get their sins forgiven by Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Who is not in need of getting their sins forgiven? From the young to the old from among us. We all need to get our sins. We're all in need of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala's maghfira. فيقول الشيخ والمعنى من صام إيمانا بشرع الله تعالى له تصديقا بذلك. And the meaning is, whomsoever fasts with iman, full conviction, that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala legislated this act of worship, tasdiqan bithalika, and he fully believes in it with conviction, wahtisaban, yani ihtisab al-ajri indahu subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he seeks the reward from Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. La mujarrad taqleeduhu lil-nasi wala riya'a. He doesn't fast just because, for example, his father is a Muslim, his father fasts, his uncles fast, his brothers and his sisters fast, so he just fasts. That's not what the intended meaning of Ramadan is. It's not the intended meaning of Ramadan. We don't carry out an action, taqleedan lin-nas, yani just blind following the people. Nor does a person do it out of showing off. بل يصومه احتسابا يرجو ما عند الله تبارك وتعالى ويؤمن بأنه فرض عليه شرعه الله له. He says, لا, He does it seeking the reward and what is with Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, and he believes, as I mentioned before, that it's an obligation upon him that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala legislated. فَهَذَا يَكُونُ صَوْمُهُ فِيهِ خَيْرٌ عَظِيمٌ. The person that does this, إخواني وأخواتي في الله, that is the person who will attain tremendous rewards from Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. وَمِنْ أَسْبَابِ الْمَغْفِرَةِ. And this from the means, the ways of attaining the forgiveness of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Guys, today there's not many questions. Usually when we have a class, you guys are just firing questions left, right and center such that we can't, okay, Bismillah. That's correct. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. I did actually say that. I did actually say that. In the previous lesson, sometimes the questions can get a bit too much. But in a dars like this, where I'm just doing all the talking, when you guys ask a question, it gives me a chance to take a sip of water. So if there's... Okay, Bismillah.
Okay, what's the ruling on the person who fasts, but they don't pray?
Because excellent question. The question is, what is the ruling on the one that fasts, but he doesn't pray? Yeah, and he doesn't pray before the month of Ramadan comes, or he just doesn't pray at all? Hatta in Ramadan as well? The person that does this has missed the whole maqsood, the intention of fasting. The one that only fasts, but he doesn't pray, then Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, not that Allah is in need, but there is no need for that person to do that action. Excellent.
Cannot be one of them if
excellent. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala yunadi al-mu'mineen. When Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kutiba alaykum al-siyam. O you who believe. The one that doesn't pray, there's a deficiency in his belief. I'm not going to go and say he's a kafir, he's outside the fold of Islam. Although there are ulama that say the one that doesn't pray, he leaves the fold of al-Islam. But this is an issue, a mas'ala, that we mentioned in the past that requires a lot of detail. Why has the person left off the salah? Does he deny the wajub of the salah? Or does he say, la, I know it's wajib, but I'm lazy? It depends.
He's a Muslim. Yeah, he's a Muslim. Allah calls us in different categories. But this time, he calls those who are believed already.
For sure. Now,
does someone who complains about the difficulty of fasting, does this fall under disliking fasting?
Question is, the one that complains about the difficulty of fasting, does this come under disliking the month of Ramadan? I can't think of anything which suggests that if somebody talks about the difficulty of something, it means that it is disliking. Because naturally, there are certain things that you might find difficult. But just because you might find something difficult and mention it, doesn't mean that you particularly... Exactly. However, is it recommended to complain? No. At the end of the day, it is not an obligation upon the Muslim to love a particular action. What's upon the Muslim is to do it. Alright? For example, I can't remember what it was, last Ramadan or the Ramadan before it. We had to fast like 18 hours, 19 hours without food and drink and the other, you know, things that we like to enjoy as Muslims. So if somebody was to ask you, do you like going without food for 18, 19 hours? You might not like it, especially as Ramadan comes to an end. Sometimes standing for Taraweeh, let alone Qiyam al-Layl, is difficult. Do you like standing to the point where your back hurts, your feet hurt, get to bed late, got to wake up early? You might not like it, but that's not an issue if you like it or not. If you like it, then that's khayr. If you like an act of worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is obligated, you love doing it, then Allah has blessed you. But you won't always find something enjoyable. But does that change whether you have to do it or not? Completely different story. Hajj. Sa'ab. Anyone been for Hajj? Or Umrah in the month of Ramadan? See how packed it is?
Yeah. If you go for Umrah in Ramadan, do you still have to fast? Because you'll be a traveler.
No. Yeah, that's an excellent question. The traveler, he has a concession to break his fast. He has a concession. And I'll tell you a funny story. I was doing Umrah in Ramadan, and we done the Umrah just before Fajr came in, so we could do it and you could eat and, you know, get your strength. So I took the concession. I took the concession that I'm a traveler, because we was going back to Medina. I used to live in Medina at the time. So I took the concession to eat. So, the adhan went for Fajr, my wife stopped eating, her brother stopped eating, and I started eating. And I just remember having a 7-Up in my hand, the days when I used to drink fizzy drinks. And because I chose, and I didn't have the intention to fast, because we said that fasting is with the niyyah, right? I never had the intention. So I just thought, let me just drink this fizzy drink, because I'm not going to get rewarded even if I did start fasting. So I just opened it, I maybe took 2 or 3 sips. By the time we got downstairs to the hotel, at the bottom of the hotel in the foyer area, jumped in a taxi, and we went straight to Medina. I kid you not, it was about 30 minutes before it was time to break fast. I was so upset. I just told the driver to stop anywhere so I can eat, just so I didn't waste the fact that I took the concession not to fast. Does that make sense? You with me? So to answer your question, now, if somebody makes Umrah in the month of Ramadan, he's not required to fast at all. I want to ask you guys a question.
Is it not looked upon as a bit weird or like strange if you're...
I mean, the people may look at him quite strange, so I mean, I would recommend if you do that, go to your hotel and do what you need to do in the hotel. You with me? Not in front of the people.
Sure.
Quick question.
Yeah, I know. It's about what the brother said.
Okay.
It's a little bit confused to me, because what's the purpose of go for Umrah during the Ramadan? Why not doing it before Ramadan, when you know that you're not going to fast? Because I can see that person is losing a big reward.
He may be losing a big reward from one angle, but he's gaining a tremendous reward from another angle. I believe, and I'm 99% sure, there's the hadith that states that the one that does Umrah in Ramadan, it says if he performed another tremendous act with the Prophet
ﷺ.
I was going to say Hajj, but I was a bit more taraddid. So from one angle, he may be losing out on the blessings of the fast, but he's getting a tremendous reward from another aspect. Additionally, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has given him that concession. There's absolutely no sin on the person who legitimately travels. It doesn't have to be for Umrah, he could travel anywhere. If he's legitimately traveling in the month of Ramadan, such that he doesn't have to fast, there's nothing upon that person. What's upon somebody is if he travels or he intentionally selects the date to travel, which coincides with Ramadan, so he doesn't have to fast. And then he tries to make it up in the winter time when he knows that the days are short and the nights are long. He's playing with the religion. That's the person that is will be sinful. And again, Nuruddin, the one that goes that travels, he doesn't have to break his fast. It's an option for him to break his fast. So it's possible that somebody can go for Umrah and he feels, I'm strong enough to perform the Umrah without fasting. Does that make sense? He has the choice for the traveler. My question, guys, Ikhwani, I don't want you to put up your hand for the answer. Don't try this one out. Every single year, because of the changes in the, I think it's the ozone layer, I don't know, but Ramadan is getting closer and closer. Like before, it was like in September, and now it would to August. What are you laughing at? Yeah, I just threw it out there. I was hoping nobody would, pull me up about that. My geography and my all of that is rubbish. I studied the religion, that's it. Bismillah. Luna and all that, yeah. Okay, barakallahu feekum. I'm going to edit that one out of the let's forget about the ozone there for 1 second. Taib, Ramadan, because of the lunar calendar and whatnot, it keeps getting closer and closer. Now Ramadan's going to be in May, is that right?
Yeah.
Taib, what do we do? Hands up for this question, yeah? What do we do? Because obviously Ramadan keeps going forward and forward, thus Hajj is going to go forward and forward as well. Hajj is about a month or so after Ramadan. What do we do? It may be in 5 years' time, 10 years' time, if Ramadan coincides with the Hajj. Do we fast or do we make Hajj? Because Hajj, kama qala an-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-Hajj al-Mabroor, laysa lahu jaza illa al-Jannah. An accepted Hajj, there's no reward except for it, except a paradise. And we know, man sama Ramadan imanan wa ihtisaban ghufira lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbi. Hal huwa su'al wadih? Don't shout out the answer, but is the question clear? Whoa, don't shout out the answer, Ikhwani.
Is it possible?
You know the answer? Sheikh Mustafa, you know the answer?
Yes.
What's the answer?
You have to fast.
He has to fast. Yeah. So he fasts even though Hajj is also a pillar of Al-Islam?
Yeah, but he translates Hajj.
Guys, please don't shout out the answer.
He translates Hajj, yeah, whenever you're ready.
Whenever you're ready, anytime you can go for Hajj? No, that's that's true. That's true. So if Ramadan falls at the same time Hajj, we have to give precedence to Ramadan over Hajj? Indeed, indeed, indeed. What do you say, Akhi? Yep, yep. What's your opinion? What's your theory? What do you say, Akhi? He has to fast. So he doesn't make Hajj?
Because he can do another year.
Good, good. That's true, he
that
can.
That would be incorrect though, because if this...
Okay.
You know, he had the means to go for Hajj, yeah. Which is obligatory point. You can't say, I'm going to delay Hajj till next year, even though I've got the means to go now.
True, true, true. What do you say, Akhi? He goes for Hajj. Gee. Can you put your hands down? I know you know the answer. I know you know the answer. Ikhwani, I ask this
question.
Is it possible? And the test Adri Anna?
No.
Are you actually
no way that can happen? Because Ramadan is a month.
Mumtaz. It's impossible for that to happen. It's impossible for that to happen. Impossible, 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 impossible. Impossible for Ramadan and Hajj to come at the same time. Because Ramadan is a month, Hajj is a month. You know why I asked you that question, guys? For you to see if you guys... I don't mind that you got it wrong. I don't mind. Wallahi, I don't mind that you got it wrong. But I want to see who's thinking. Who's thinking? In addition to the fact that the brother shouted out the answer, despite me politely asking, no one shouted out the answer. That's a, yeah, it's all of that. It's all together. It's all connected. I heard that there was a man in a particular city claiming to be the Mahdi. Or something crazy like that, like maybe a couple of years ago. So he went to a brother, and the brother posed this question to him. You know? He posed this question to him, and the guy answered. He didn't say it's impossible. He either said you have to go for Hajj, or he said you have to fast. Exposed him for who he really was. You hear me, guys? Let's clarify that. If there was any misunderstandings, it's impossible for Hajj and Ramadan to come at the same time. Why? It's like me saying, can February and July come at the same time?
No.
Two separate months. Two separate months. You with me, Akhi? So what do you do then? If you had the money to go for Hajj, but Ramadan came at the same time as Hajj, what would you do, Akhi? Ramadan or Hajj? Which one's more important? I'm asking you.
You can see that question again.
If Ramadan, you got the money to go for Hajj, you're not sick, you're strong, tayyib, and Ramadan comes at the same time. What do you do? Do you go for Hajj or do you fast the blessed month of Ramadan? Mumtaz. Excellent. Be confident, Akhi. Be confident. Be confident. Jazakallahu khayra. Tayyib. I've mentioned, Ikhwan, what time's the adhan? 15. Okay, let's try and see if we can get through some more information, inshallah ta'ala. I mentioned that Ramadan, Ikhwani, is much more than merely leaving off food and drink. Alright? Ramadan is much more than leaving off food and drink. In addition, I mentioned that there are certain things that are halal that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala does not want us to engage in during the time that we're fasting, i.e. sexual relations with our wives, In addition, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, outside the month of Ramadan, but even more so inside the month of Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need of the ones fast who, and Allah doesn't need anything, who engages in foul speech, qawl az-zur. Alright? And this is something that we have to try. If you're somebody that is tested with ill speech and lying, backbiting and ghibah, namima outside the month of Ramadan, you need to try extra hard inside the month of Ramadan, because it's going to be a musiba, a calamity, for you to go through the whole blessed month of Ramadan and you benefit nothing except by being hungry and by being thirsty. What did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wasallam say in a hadith collected by Al-Bukhari? مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ وَالْعَمَلُ بِهِ وَالْجَهَلْ فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةً إِلَىٰ أَنْ يَدَعَ طَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ. Whomsoever does not leave off